Hello, everyone, and thanks for being with us tonight. Our presentation tonight will last for approximately 1 hour and will be presented by urologist Dr. Luke Cho of Advanced Urology Associates. Dr. Cho received his undergraduate degrees in philosophy and biochemistry from Northwestern University in Evanston and University of Illinois in Chicago. He earned his medical degree from the University of Illinois at Chicago as well in 1996. Dr. Cho did his residency at Yale New Haven Hospital, Yale School of Medicine in New Haven, Connecticut, where he was also the chief resident of urology. So Dr. Cho, thank you so much for giving us your time tonight, and I'll turn it over to you now.
Okay, thanks, Jack. Once again, thanks for logging on for this webinar. We're going to be discussing BPH, diagnosis and treatments. What we'll cover will be an overview of the prostate, what the organ is designed to do and why we have a prostate. Then we'll talk about the condition known as BPH, which really is synonymous with an enlarged prostate. And then finally, what we do about treating an enlarged prostate when it becomes a problem. So first off, the prostate overview. So what is the prostate? Typically, we talk about what size the prostate ought to be. And in general, we like to say that the prostate is approximately a walnut sized. It's a gland that's at the base of the bladder. So if you look at the picture, it kind of gives you a strategic view. And it surrounds the urethra. So this is a cross-section of the prostate, but that's where the problems can lie, is if the prostate becomes very large, there's a lot of muscle tissue in the prostate, and that can constrict the urethra at this location. It's sort of a bottleneck, you might say. The purpose of the prostate is to produce fluid that helps sperm transport during reproduction. So it's strictly a reproductive organ, but it's for basically providing nutrients to the semen. It does grow, and according to our reference here, says that the prostate grows to about normal adult size in your early 20s, and then it starts to grow again in a lot of men later on, and starting in middle age. Okay, so different types of conditions the prostate can suffer from. Well, BPH is our primary focus here, and that, like I said, is synonymous with an enlarged prostate. However, the prostate can become inflamed or infected, and so commonly we refer to that as a prostatitis. And then lastly, the prostate can become cancerous, and unfortunately, it's one of the most common male cancers in the United States. So prostate cancer is definitely one of the conditions that we're very concerned about. That won't be the topic of our discussion today, however. So an overview about an enlarged prostate, or BPH. Okay, so first of all, BPH is an acronym, and it stands for, over here, benign prostatic hyperplasia. Hyperplasia is a term that we use to designate more cells than normal. So I guess if you take this literally, it's a non-cancerous enlargement of the prostate. Okay, the normal, once again, the normal adult size of a prostate is around 1.5 inches in diameter. I would say that's a fairly small prostate in somebody who's younger, but as we get older, we probably want to aim for the walnut size type of prostate gland. Benign prostatic hyperplasia or enlargement can lead to what we refer to as bladder outlet obstruction. And based on that last picture that we saw, that's what we're trying to convey. And then the symptoms of a bladder outlet obstruction, we generally refer to as something called LUTS, or lower urinary tract symptoms. So once again, just to stress the point, does BPH mean that you have prostate cancer? And basically, BPH is not related to prostate cancer. There is no correlation at this time, as best we can tell. So going through the bullet points here, BPH is not prostate cancer. It does not cause prostate cancer. The symptoms of BPH are similar to those of cancer. And in my opinion, that would be if the cancer is advanced. If it's a very early stage prostate cancer, you will have no symptoms. So a lot of men come into the office complaining or worried about whether or not their urinary symptoms is due to prostate cancer. And the vast majority of times it's not, but the only one who can tell is probably a urologist based on a number of tests. However, BPH may also exist with prostate cancer, and that's an important point as well. You can have both conditions at the same time, especially as we get older as men. And the PSA level, or prostate-specific antigen, do not distinguish BPH from prostate cancer. In other words, the PSA test is often used as a screening test for prostate cancer, but it really isn't designed to detect prostate cancer alone. It could represent many other conditions, including BPH, if it's elevated. Hopefully that makes sense. And this is a picture just to illustrate the differences between an enlarged prostate and what we consider a normal prostate. As the prostate enlarges, pressure can be put on the urethra. And like we discussed before, the urethra will become constricted. So in this picture here, where the prostate is shown to be enlarged, the urethra is constricted. And then what can happen is the bladder will start to become more distended and become more irritated, and you can start retaining more urine. One more point to make, though, is an enlarged prostate is not the only criteria to cause bladder obstruction. So it is important to note that a lot of times the prostate size does not always correlate with the degree or severity of urinary symptoms. And we'll get into that a little bit later. It's as much about the shape of the prostate as the size of the prostate. So what are the symptoms of an enlarged prostate or BPH? Well, there's many, and they're not all, let's say, consistent. So some men will have certain types of symptoms and others will have other types of symptoms. But in general, you could say that somebody who has frequent urination during the day or the night, a sudden urge they have to urinate, certainly any burning in the urethra when you're urinating, a weak flow, and then after completing urination, feeling like the bladder is still not empty and that there's more to come out. Also trouble stopping or starting the flow. And then last but not least, you have to go, you know you have to urinate, but you can't initiate it or start the urination. There's others, but these are fairly typical. And again, they may be in combination, and some may have more severe symptoms, specific symptoms than others. BPH can affect our quality of life by all means. That's the main reason why people come to our office about their urinary symptoms. Many men who suffer from BPH may experience a reduction in their quality of life. So some statistics about how it affects us: up to 95% of men with moderate symptoms are unhappy and don't want to spend the rest of their lives with these symptoms. 51% of men state that it interferes with an aspect of their normal life, such as having to get up a lot at night and not getting enough sleep. Over here, 49% of men experience sexual problems associated with their urinary tract symptoms. And that is a correlation. It's not necessarily a causation, but there is definitely a high correlation to sexual dysfunction and BPH. And then BPH, lastly, affects men's partner's quality of life. Obviously, your spouse or a better half may notice a lot of your symptoms, and they may in turn have to be concerned. And, is as simple as getting up a lot at night or noticing that you're going to the bathroom more frequently. Who can get BPH? Well, the most common cause is in patients who are over 50 years of age. It affects 50% of men by age 50, and it affects 90% of men by age 85. So it's quite prevalent as we get older, especially in our later years. Some statistics: in 2010, as many as 14 million men in the United States had lower urinary tract symptoms. Okay. And obesity, or high body mass index, and the lack of exercise may increase the risk of BPH. This is also an important point to make. Just by losing weight, then, your risk of BPH may go down. How do we diagnose an enlarged prostate? Well, there's two main ways. One is by prostate examination, okay? Besides the symptoms, of course, but by prostate exam, you can tell a lot. You can get a general sense of how large somebody's prostate is. And there's also urinary output testing. There's two ways that we like to do this in an office setting. When you come to the office, a lot of times we'll ask for a urine specimen. And then immediately after urinating, we'll check to see if there's any remaining urine in the bladder. And that's important. It's not just about how much urine you produce. It's about how much urine is left over. And if you think about it, you should be completely empty when you're done urinating. But oftentimes, men don't recognize that the bladder isn't completely empty. And that's why we'll check with a bladder scan immediately after urination. So that's called a post-void residual urine. And then the second way we check for the signs or presence of BPH is a urinary flow rate. We do this when we're getting a little bit more suspicious. We'll have patients urinate into a machine that measures the flow of their stream, and that correlates with obstruction. So if the stream is very weak and the flow rate is very low, then we start to be suspicious of an obstruction. And in men, middle age and beyond, one of the most common reasons would be BPH. Last but not least, we talk about symptoms, and there is actually a way to quantify the severity of BPH symptoms. And one of the most commonly used symptom scores is something called the International Prostate Symptom Score. We use this in the office, and oftentimes we'll have patients who are before, during, and after BPH treatment fill out these scores to see how their treatment is going along. But there's other questionnaires as well, and they're fairly highly correlated to the presence of BPH. Okay, so we've gone through what the prostate does and how it affects men. And let's say you're having a lot of problems from the enlarged prostate, or at least significant enough that you want to have further evaluation. And we've determined that it's not prostate cancer, it's not anything else other than the enlarged prostate. So what do we do about it? Okay, so we can start off with the least invasive first. And what I like to say is, what kind of treatments can the patient do directly that they can control? Well, certainly behavior modification, which means, believe it or not, if you have an enlarged prostate and your bladder has a hard time emptying, you want to minimize the types of fluids that produce a lot of urine quickly. And so fluid and diet changes. I always tell patients, if you have an excessive amount of caffeine and alcohol in your diet, then that certainly will make your symptoms worse. So always use that in moderation, or just realize that if you drink a lot of those fluids, then your symptoms will get worse. We talk about watchful waiting, which essentially means, in my opinion, if the symptoms are present, but they're not very severe, they're not affecting your life very much, you can certainly just watch them and then keep an eye on it and look for signs that they're getting worse over time. But it may take many, many years. Some patients, it may never get worse than a certain degree, and certainly watchful waiting in the early stages is fine. There's also Kegel and bladder retraining. My feeling about that would be, if you're having severe enough symptoms that you want to be more proactive, then you can learn some bladder exercises and retraining exercises to try to control some of those symptoms. However, I'd get a little nervous if you're relying on that solely and not being monitored on a regular basis, because those symptoms can sometimes be an indication of more severe BPH-related complications. Okay, and so beyond behavior modification, then we go to first-line therapies, or what we often call the first-line therapies, as the first thing that you can try. Traditionally, a lot of patients will feel that the first thing that you should do it beyond the diet and behavior modifications would be medication. So there's a lot of different BPH medications on the market. There's also some supplements. However, that's one of the first line treatments. And then now there's this whole category of treating enlarged prostate with minimally invasive office procedures, minimally invasive BPH surgeries. And there's two on the market that are pretty well known at this time. And one of them is the Rezūm Water Vapor Therapy, which is a main focus of our talk today. And another one that sort of competes with that is something called UroLift, or permanent implants. And we'll briefly just touch on that as well. But over the years, there's been many office-based BPH procedures. They've come and gone, and some of them still exist. And that won't all be talked about in this discussion, but there are several procedures over the years that have been on the market. And then last but not least, there's the formal surgical procedures. In a lot of ways, the minimally invasive procedures are surgeries. They're just done in an office setting. But for the purpose of this discussion, surgical procedures will be procedures that are considered more invasive, requiring general anesthesia, or even possibly a stay in the hospital and recovery. And in brief, there are three general surgical procedures that we talk about: green light laser therapy of the prostate, a procedure known as TURP, which stands for transurethral resection of the prostate, and last but not least, removal of the prostate itself. And so at the bottom of this screen, you can see that the level of invasiveness of these procedures, we're going from less to the most invasive on the right, and these first-line therapies are somewhere in the middle. But I don't want you to think that they're 50% of the less invasive procedures versus the most invasive. It's just sort of where it lies in the overall invasiveness grand scheme of things. One comment about alternative medicines or supplements. There's no dietary supplement combination of phytotherapeutic agents or conventional therapy that is recommended for the management of lower urinary tract symptoms secondary to BPH. This includes saw palmetto and urtica dioica. Okay, so let's talk briefly about watchful waiting. This may involve simple lifestyle modifications and adjusting your diet, taking your fluids earlier in the day so that by the time you get to bed, you're not waking up as often at night, and certain types of exercise patterns. There are some potential side effects, and if your prostate continues to grow throughout your lifetime, watchful waiting may not be enough for you. Okay. So we should talk about medications, since that's a very important part of treating BPH, and it has been and probably will be. There's two types of medications. One of them called alpha blockers, and what they are is essentially a fancy muscle relaxer. Okay, we all have muscle relaxing medications in our treatment regimen, but it helps to relax the muscles in both the bladder and the prostate. And what we're trying to do is not shrink the prostate with these drugs, but what it'll do is it'll help open up the urethra, at least we hope so. And by doing that, it'll relieve some of the blockage in the prostate. Now, there are some discouraging statistics about alpha blockers. As you can see here, 71% of patients stop taking their medication within a year. And that could be for a variety of reasons. One is certainly side effects, but also due to lack of efficacy. If it's not really helping you very much, you're sort of discouraged that your symptoms are not getting better on the medicine, and rightfully so, a lot of patients will not take it. Another reason why people may not take these drugs is they may just be afraid of it. They just don't like the idea of these medications and what they're doing to their bodies over the long term. All very valid reasons why alpha blockers are maybe not the best first-line treatment. But the advantage is obviously it's not surgery, so there's no anesthesia, there's no permanent implants, and there you have it. Some of the unique side effects of alpha blockers include a potential drop in your blood pressure. So if that were to happen, we always tell patients to be on the lookout for that. You could start to feel dizzy or lightheaded. You could feel tired because of that. And there's also the possibility that the medications can interact with other drugs that also potentially can cause low blood pressure. So if you have two drugs, then all of a sudden your blood pressure could drop even more suddenly and severely, which obviously could be dangerous. I want to mention one more thing though, is alpha blockers are the most commonly prescribed class of drugs for an enlarged prostate. And we do prescribe them fairly often. And you'll see many men on this medicine for their enlarged prostate. The second type of BPH medicine is in a category known as 5-alpha reductase inhibitors. It's a long word, but what this medicine is going to do is shrink the prostate. So the alpha blockers were to relax the prostate. This medication class is shrinking the prostate. And it shrinks the prostate by lowering the production of a certain hormone known as DHT. And it's you can think of it as a form of testosterone. It's not the testosterone that we all know and talk about, but it is a specific type of testosterone that is highly effective on the prostate. The prostate is very sensitive to it. So by blocking that hormone, the prostate can shrink. Let's see here. So again, the same argument and statistics apply to alpha blockers, I'm sorry, as it does 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, which is there's a high drop-off rate. Up to 71% of patients stop taking their medications within the year. Same potential circumstances surrounding the medications. There's no anesthesia, obviously. There's no implants, and it's not a surgical procedure. This medication has potential side effects that are fairly unique and sort of strange if you talk to a lot of men. It does lower the PSA. Now, that doesn't necessarily mean it lowers your prostate cancer risk, although that there is a study that showed that, but it does lower the PSA, and that can be lowered as much as 50% within the first 6 months, let's say. One of the disadvantages of this medicine is it takes 6 months to fully kick in, is what I say to patients. And by the end of the 6 months, then the medicine probably will have reduced the patient's prostate size by about 30%. and their PSA usually drops by about 50%. Now, there are other side effects, including erectile dysfunction and a lowered sex drive and something known as retrograde ejaculation. Actually, retrograde ejaculation is more commonly seen with alpha blockers. It can happen with 5-alpha reductase inhibitors, but I would say that most of the time, these class of drugs would cause a sexual dysfunction that's related more to ejaculatory dysfunction. In other words, it's hard to achieve a climax rather than the erectile dysfunction or retrograde ejaculation. But nonetheless, these are all supposed potential side effects. Okay, so we're going to talk about some of the procedures now. Now, before we get started, we're going to talk about the least invasive first and then the more invasive later. But I do want to reserve the end of the talk to the Rezūm technique, which is still considered one of the least invasive procedures. But that happens to be my preferred minimally invasive BPH procedure. And I want to stress that. So that's why we'll save that for the last. But another office procedure that's widely available, including in our office, is something known as prostatic urethral lift. The trade name is UroLift. There's quite a bit of advertising going on over the last couple years. What is it? It is essentially what they call a non-surgical outpatient procedure that uses permanent implants to lift and hold the enlarged prostate tissue out of the way. It's sort of kind of thinking, to me, it's sort of like a stapler device that's passed through the urethra, and that stapler will cause the urethra that's obstructed to be pulled apart by these staples. We can do this procedure without general anesthesia, although a lot of patients would prefer to have it. And it does involve a permanent implant, meaning those clips or staples are in the patient permanently unless they're surgically removed later on. So with that in mind, you would say to ourselves, well, will I ever need to have it removed? And according to many studies, there's up to a 13% chance that you'll need another surgical procedure down the road. And so therefore, up to 13% of men through 5 years will probably have to have another procedure. And that's where those implants may come into play here. There are side effects to any surgical procedure. We'll talk about some of them here. For the UroLift, what's been described as some pain or discomfort when urinating, I would say that's most likely to happen in the first few days after the procedure, but it could linger on for longer than that. It's not uncommon to see blood in the urine immediately after the procedure. After all, you've perforated the urethra with these staples. Pelvic pain, urinary stone has been described. What happens is these clips are considered foreign bodies. Any clip or in the urinary tract has the potential to form a stone on it. The urine has this quality of producing stones with any form object that's in the bladder. People who have catheters in their bladder, eventually they'll start to develop stones. If you've ever had to have a ureteral stent because, let's say, a kidney stone, that stent cannot stay in forever and those can develop stones. And then last but not least, the clips themselves can be a source of irritation to the urethra and bladder, and that in turn can cause frequent urination and urgent urination to the point where you have leakage. So these are our potential side effects, certainly not necessarily unique to UroLift, but I think the fact that it's a permanent implant contributes to some of these side effects more than others. Okay, so we'll go to the next level of invasiveness, which is something called the green light laser therapy. So green light laser therapy is a surgical procedure. Oftentimes it's done as an outpatient, and we're using a laser to vaporize the tissue that's causing the obstruction away from the urethra. Now, when we're doing this procedure, the laser will essentially vaporize the urethra lining and then get into the prostate itself. So we're creating a cavity within the prostate. And the idea is to remove the obstructing tissue to allow the urine to flow through the prostate more easily. But in order to do so, This laser technique is going to vaporize the tissue. Do you require general anesthesia? Most definitely, yes. I would highly doubt that anyone would have this done without general anesthesia. Are there implants? No, there's no implants. And the success rates of green light laser therapy is usually very, very good. It's one of the best on the market, but it's not perfect, just like any procedure. And this reference states that there's up to a 4.8% surgical retreatment rate at 5 years. And I would say that sounds pretty reasonable depending on what size of prostate you're starting with, and how much laser treatment you do at those during that particular operation. Side effects of green light laser therapy. There are some unique ones, and we'll list some of them here. Some pain or discomfort when urinating. Again, this is most likely to happen in the first week or two after the procedure. You could definitely see blood in the urine. And they mentioned urinary retention, urinary tract infections, and urgency and frequency. All of these are potential risks of any surgical procedure. I don't feel like they're necessarily any higher in green light than any other procedure as well, but these are all potential side effects. One thing I'd like to say about the green light laser therapy, at least in my experience, I've done a lot of them early on in my career. When the technology first became available, I probably did over 100 of them. And they do work, and they do work very well. But from my perspective, it's a laser that takes a while to get the same amount of results as, let's say, a TURP, which we'll discuss later. So the time required to get the results that you're looking for is a little longer in the operating room. And the advantage to a green light that I see is that it is very good at controlling bleeding. And so people who have very large bloody prostates, this type of laser, I think, makes a lot of sense. But the way it controls the bleeding is that the laser is very powerful. And if you're using a lot of high energy into the prostate, I think that potentially can cause an increased risk of pain and burning sensation afterwards, which I definitely saw in some of my patients. It wasn't certainly a lot of patients, but the ones that had significant pain that lingered on for weeks, if not months, it made me think twice about using green light laser therapy at times. Nonetheless, it's a very popular laser. Most urologists are experienced in using it. It has excellent results. It has a very low risk for side effects. And I'm not by any means saying that it's not a good technology, but that's sort of my experience with green light laser. Okay, and then we're going to go to the next. Oh, this is just more information about how it works. So again, the green light laser, this is we have a little video about how it works, but this is the fiber in which the laser energy is delivered to the prostate. And if you look to the left, you can see this cartoon where we're targeting the center part of the prostate here, where the urethra is being constricted. And hopefully after the laser therapy, the tissue on the sides of the prostate have been removed. And this would assume that we've had some healing here and the urethral layer has sort of regenerated. You can think of it that way. But in this situation now, the prostate is no longer obstructing the urethra and therefore you have this opening in the urethra. At least that's what they're trying to show here. We can show a little video of the green light laser technique. I think that gives a good synopsis of the green light technique. We'll move on. Transurethral resection of the prostate, or TURP. You may hear this term very often. Certainly several years ago when I was in training and med school, the TURP operation was widely used because there was no green light laser or Rezūm. What this is sort of the euphemistic term of the Roto-Rooter, I think. A lot of patients sort of understand what we're talking about when we use that term. But it's a surgical outpatient procedure. Now, I wouldn't say it's the majority are outpatient. I would say the majority of patients who are undergoing this surgery stay one night in the hospital. It does require general anesthesia. There's no permanent implants. And the success rates, according to this reference here, is 5.8% success without need for another treatment after 5 years. Some of the side effects of a TURP, which are very well known in the literature, you can have some pain or discomfort when urinating, but this is pretty minimal, and I don't see as much of the burning pain that I mentioned about green light. You will definitely see some blood in the urine. I would say you should expect to have bloody urine, and that's the main reason why patients have to be admitted overnight. We have to monitor for that. There is a risk of urinary tract infection and urinary retention. Obviously, in my opinion, we're doing this procedure to help with urinary retention. So if there's still urinary retention, that may be a failure of the procedure, or the patient's prostate problem is so severe that this type of operation didn't really work. But nonetheless, these are all potential risks, like I said, about any surgical procedure. Okay, so we don't have a cartoon or video about the TURP, but just suffice to say, you can think of it like the green light video, but instead of using a laser to burn the tissue away, you're literally scraping it away, utilizing electrical current through a little wire loop that's passed through the camera. And it's creating a cavity within the prostate, just like the green light, but the method that you use, the technology and the energy that you're using is different. Hopefully that's enough for everyone to understand. And then last but not least, you can remove the prostate entirely. This, I would say, is the most invasive way of handling BPH, of course. That's a surgical procedure where traditionally you make an incision in near down by the bladder, and there is a significant amount more bleeding with this technique. Occasionally, your need for a blood transfusion is realized in this procedure. The recovery is longer, and you know, we reserve this type of operation for men with the largest prostates that are out there. If you have an extremely large prostate and you're high risk of having complications and the other less invasive procedures aren't going to work, then oftentimes urologists may have to resort to a total prostate removal. This is different though than the technique used for prostate cancer. You can remove the prostate for prostate cancer, but when we're talking about just BPH, it's a different sort of an operation. Interestingly enough, it can be just as bloody as a cancer surgery. We won't talk too much more about it, but just realize that this is still an option that's probably reserved for men with the largest prostate, extremely large prostates. I'm talking about on the range of a size of an apple or orange, sometimes a little smaller than that if the other techniques are just not going to work. And lastly, I want to talk about Rezūm water vapor therapy. This is in the category of the one of the least invasive procedures. It's a procedure that I've been performing since 2019, and by now I've performed over 150 of these surgeries, and I think it works very well. I think it fits very nicely into the treatment options for patients, and let's spend some time on this. What is Rezūm water vapor therapy? Well, we're calling it non-surgical, but by no means is it not a procedure. We are performing a procedure. And it is an outpatient therapy. All patients go home after this procedure. Essentially, we're using water vapor to shrink the prostate tissue that's obstructing the urethra. And we're using this term very strategically, you might say. A lot of times we talk about using steam, but technically that's not accurate. Steam has a temperature of 100 degrees centigrade. And the water vapor treatment is, I believe, 70 degrees centigrade. So it's a little bit cooler than the steam. And the reason for that, in my opinion, is because we don't need that much heat. If you have too much energy, once again, that can cause other side effects. And through their research, they've determined that 70 degrees is probably quite adequate to achieve the results of what they're trying to accomplish here. Once again, you don't have to have general anesthesia for Rezūm. You could have this done under local anesthetic and some oral sedation. There's no permanent implants. And the surgical retreatment rate has been reported to be very low. Up to 4.4% of patients who undergo Rezūm require a secondary treatment after 5 years. And if you take it on the flip side, the success rate of Rezūm therapy after 5 years is close to 96%, which is excellent. And so for an office-based procedure that requires no general anesthesia, no implants, and literally can take up to 5 minutes or less of treatment, I think this is a very, very compelling option for most men. Now, side effects that have been reported for Rezūm, once again, a lot of these symptoms we've talked about, and there is oftentimes some pain or discomfort when urinating in the urethra. typically in the first few days to the first couple of weeks after the procedure. I would say the vast majority of patients no longer complain of pain, but there will be probably some irritating urinary discomfort in the urethra. You can see blood in the urine for sure after this procedure, and blood in the semen. And then you can have urinary frequency. But once again, these are all, this is not unique to Rezūm. All procedures can experience, all procedures have these side effects potentially. Typically, a lot of these side effects go away, like I said, after about 1 to 2 weeks. Okay, so here's another presentation about the technique in general. Once again, on the left, we're targeting the prostate tissue that immediately surrounds the urethra. This is probably the most contributing factor to the urethral obstruction. And again, after about 3 to 4 weeks, at least in my experience, the urethra has opened up nicely after the healing process has taken place, or much of the healing process. And we have a video for you that show you how this technique is performed.
Rezūm uses the natural energy stored in water vapor or steam. Clinical studies support that Rezūm relieves BPH symptoms safely and effectively, eliminating the need for BPH medications while also preserving sexual function. During each 9-second treatment, sterile water vapor is released throughout the targeted prostate tissue. When the steam contacts the tissue and turns back into water, all the stored energy is released, causing the cells to die. Over time, your body's natural healing response absorbs the dead cells, shrinking the prostate. With the extra tissue removed, the urethra opens, reducing BPH symptoms. Most patients begin to experience symptom relief as soon as 2 weeks, and maximum benefit may occur within 3 months.
All right, so some statistics about Rezūm. Patient satisfaction is very high. I agree with this. Very, very often patients are very happy 3 to 4 weeks after the procedure when I see them in follow-up. 97% of patients would recommend Rezūm to a friend. That would be on some studies based on 255 patients. And you may be concerned about insurance coverage. It is the responsibility of the patient to contact their insurance provider. We also assist in that manner too. We would certainly want to get pre-authorization for the procedure. Medicare is a very common insurance provider for Rezūm patients, but private insurance has been pretty receptive to covering this procedure as well. So in general, we don't run into too many problems with insurance coverage with Rezūm. So in summary, what is the prostate and how it works, and the definition of BPH, all of these things we've talked about. Treatment options, including watchful waiting, first-line therapies, and the surgical procedures like we discussed. And as a next step, consultation with a urologist is required to determine which therapy is best treatment option for you. I certainly think that this is an important thing. Again, we're not just concerned about BPH. A lot of times we have to check for prostate cancer, prostate infections, and among other things that can cause the same type of symptoms. So it is important to have a urologist evaluate your urinary symptoms. And I'd like to open it up for any questions. I thank you again for attending this webinar.